Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. My name is Julio Godinez, and welcome to today's DevOps.com webinar, How to Build the Threat Model for Kubernetes Systems, brought to you by WhiteSource. We have a great webinar for you today, but before we get started, I need to go through some housekeeping announcements. Today's event is being recorded, so if you miss any part of the webinar, you will be able to access the recording for on-demand viewing. We will be sending out a link to access the webinar on-demand, or you can visit devops.com/webinars. We want to hear from you, so please feel free to send in your questions at any time throughout the program by using the Q&A tab. We also encourage discussion by using the chat tab, so let us know your thoughts or just say a quick hello. Finally, stick around until the end because we are doing a drawing for four $25 Amazon gift cards, so stay tuned to see if you're a winner. And joining me today is Mayor Curiel, Senior Product Line Manager at WhiteSource. And with that, I'm going to put myself on mute, turn off my camera, and let you begin.
Thank you very much. Thank you to everyone who joined today. My name is Mauro Curiel. I'm here working at WhiteSource with focus on cloud native solutions. Today we're going to talk about threat modeling for Kubernetes system. I'm going to walk you through a very step-by-step explanation on, first of all, what is a threat modeling? Why do you need it? And then we're going to move on specifically for Kubernetes systems, how you building this threat modeling, what are the steps. I'm going to walk you through the different steps from identifying the assets, mapping the risks, and also go over some best practices on how do you mitigate the different risks and threats that we're going to cover. And at the end, I'm going to present and cover also some actual tools and frameworks for you to take and use in your organization, in your environment, in order to protect and build that threat landscape. Okay, with that, let's get started, guys. Okay, that was just a comic break before we dive into the tech stuff and confuse you, all you guys. Okay, so let's start. So what is a threat modeling? Why do you need it? So threat modeling helps us to better understand what are we working on, what we want to protect, list out all different components that we have over there, better understand what are the risks and what are the attack vectors and how I can be infiltrated from different ways, different use cases. It helps us to align with security regulation inside my organization. It encourages a dialogue between the different teams from DevOps, security, also in management. And what is the, and from my perspective, the most important thing is the outcome, which gives us a clear understanding on what we have, how to protect, and we help to present to management and to the organization how we deliver value to the organization itself. Now, what you see over here is from the threat modeling manifesto. You can go online and see it. by yourself. It's a very cool website that helps us to better understand what are different threats, not specifically for Kubernetes, but in high level, how to build a threat modeling. I use this website and other resources that we're gonna cover in this presentation in order to build this slide deck. Okay, let's start. So for building a Kubernetes threat modeling, the first we need to do is to assess the scope of the system, identify the assets, the actor, the different entry points, all the moving parts, and better again, a clear understanding what can go wrong, identify what can be broken, where I can be attacked from, what are different threats and risks, what compromise my system, what compromise my organization. So, and after I'm mapping all the risks, all the threats, I need to identify countermeasure or assess the countermeasure that I have in my organization and manage the risks. One thing that you will hear me go over a lot in this presentation, you can't cover all the bases on day zero. You need to prioritize, you need to define what is most high priority that, risk that you want to tackle on day zero and then move forward. You need to list them to better understand what is the most risky attack vector that you have over there and what is the most important asset that you want to protect. And at the end, assess the work. Did you do a good job? Did you achieve the goal that your security or management defined for you? Okay? And when you do that, please remember the kind words of Bob Ross. There are no Kubernetes mistakes. Just happy accident, I mean breaches, you know, guys. Okay? So let's start. As we said, the first step is identify your assets. So a Kubernetes environment, like any other cloud computing platform, you need to secure it on multiple levels. Now, if you go to Kubernetes.io, you will find this diagram, but this is not the trust boundaries that I want to talk to you guys. I don't want to cover this and go over this diagram with you guys. What I want to do is go over this slide with you, this visual. Now, this one, I took it from CNCF Financial Group a year ago. They created this diagram. I found it very useful, and I'm taking it with me on my work, and helps me, first of all, explain how Kubernetes communicate internally and externally. You will be able to see inside in this diagram all the different components that Kubernetes has. From the on the top, you will see the master node with the API server and the etcd, which is the database, and the bottom right there is the worker node, and the bottom left is the image registry. You see all the relationships, all that you see all the different segregation between the physical machine and all the different components. So there's a lot of layers. There's a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of security controls that can be implemented on each component. Now I can go over and cover everything and understand, help you understand what you're seeing here if it's not so clear, but I'm afraid that if I'll start going into this slide visual and go over step by step and explain all the different steps, at the end of it, I will look like this. Okay, so what I would like you to take from this is learn that this visual is out there, understand it's a complex system, and go and use it for your need inside your organization. And of course, if you have any questions or stuff, at the beginning and at the end of the slide, there is my email address and also my Twitter handle. So feel free to reach out to me. So we mapped out all the different components, all the relationships between them. Now we need to start focusing on the security risk and threats per component that we have over there. Now, I said it before, and I'm going to say it again, attempting to evaluate all possible combination of threat agents, attack vulnerabilities, the impact that each of them has on your system is a waste of your time and a waste of effort. it's a never-ending story. There is always a new vulnerability. There is always new attack vectors. You need to be very, very focused. Okay, you need to understand what are the different risks in your system, what you want to focus on, what is the high-profile asset in your organization, and how you want to protect them. Again, a clear understanding what are the different exploits that can be used in those components, and move forward. For example, I wrote down four bullets here. One of the main attack vectors, usually in Kubernetes, is a container image. So who can deploy the container images workloads? How are they being deployed from the configuration perspective? We're also going to cover that. What service is exposed internally or external from the cluster itself? And what is the depth or the visibility that you have to your Kubernetes environment? Do you see only the workloads? Do you see also the configuration of the cluster? And what is the depth of that visibility? All of these questions will help you better understand what is the level of exposure that you have in your system to threats. And when I'm saying threats, it can be external or internal. We're going to talk about it in the upcoming slides. So as I said, I'm not going to cover all the different threats and risks, but what I am going to do, and I'm also recommend you guys to do this, is take two steps back, look at your Kubernetes cluster from a high level macro view, and reduce the complexity, all the noise, all the different challenges that you have that are confusing you guys. Focus on the primary attack vectors that you want to protect. Focus on the main assets that you want to implement security controls around, and move from there. So the main risks, number one, external attackers. External attackers, I don't feel I need to explain to anyone here what is an external attacker. People that don't have any access, but are trying to infiltrate your system. Malicious container is also a very popular attack vector. It's also a very popular way for adversaries to infiltrate into a Kubernetes system. So it can be when you download a malicious image from Docker Hub, or you use a malicious package that looks innocent, and you just run it inside your environment, and then the adversary, the attacker, will have full access to your environment. And cluster configurations. Now, this is a huge security risk. Now, last year, Red Hat did a survey that they ask enterprise organizations what are the main concerns that they have when they are deploying Kubernetes. The main concern that they have, number one on the list, if I remember correctly, or one of the top three, was cluster configurations. There is a huge lack of knowledge on how to configure it the right way. There is a huge gap between DevOps that are running and working with cluster on a day-to-day basis, and security administrators, SecOps, that they wish to implement security controls. And we need to bridge this gap in some sort of way. And of course, RBAC, role-based access control. If the system will have a malicious user with the wrong credentials, he can do whatever he wants, from running workloads, editing the etcd, and downloading stuff from his CNC server, and the list goes on and on. Now let's go one level lower. We talked about the high level, all the external threats. Now let's go inside the system and better understand. So one of the ways that adversaries are looking for to exploit our service tokens. So if a service token is mounted on a pod, then it can be used in a malicious way, and then bad stuff might happen to your environment. RBAC issues, also talked about it in the previous slide, but this is one of the many attack vectors that is most very popular. And it's they rely on that the Kubernetes system is a complex, huge system that you don't exactly know how to configure the right thing, or you miss the configuration. And the wrong post and the wrong person just trigger that configuration, and then it's a lost cause. Network ports, you need to ensure that your network policies inside the pods and outside of your Kubernetes cluster are secured, and you know what is the whitelist and the blacklist for network policies. We're going to talk about that. And one of the most things that this is the heart and soul API server. This is the Kube API is the heart of soul of every Kubernetes cluster. If I get a foot in the door inside the API server, I can do whatever I want. I can control workloads, control worker nodes. I can control the master node, even do whatever I want to do and change everything inside my cluster. And east-west traffic, and it's a long story from there. So as I said, I'm not going to cover all the threats, all the risks. What I listed over in the previous slides are the main ones that we see that are being attempted to be exploited by malicious organizations out there. So let's take it step forward, mitigations. So I want to right now, what I want to do is go over all the risks that all the threats, and see what are the best practices, what are the guidelines that I need to follow in order to protect myself. So external threats. I talked about it as the last bullet on my previous slide, and this is the first one on this slide. Your API server. API server, you need to ensure that your authorization, authentication, everything is being validated. You know exactly what and how is being communicated with your management services. Otherwise, if you leave one of these as an afterthought, someone can use it, someone can exploit it, and your system now is breached. You need to understand what services are running inside your cluster. And if you have services that need to communicate with external or untrusted sources, because this is the requirement of the application, or communicate with unauthenticated IP addresses, you need to ensure that you implement a whitelist approach, which means this is the list that addresses that I'm allowing you to communicate with. If it's not on the list, I'll block it automatically. And trust me, a whitelist approach is not very popular, but it saves a lot of pain and a lot of organizations that are trying to learn how to implement it. A whitelist approach are much more secure. Now, never, ever stop assessing your Kubernetes security posture all the time. New versions always come up, new configurations are being added. You need to assess the security posture all the time. There's a lot of benchmarks over there. There's a lot of open source tools. One of the tools that I recommend is I don't know how many you guys are identified this icon, but this is the icon for an open source tool, which is called Kubehunter. Kubehunter is, as I said, open source free tool that assess the security posture of your cluster, and it runs internal and external penetration tests based on best practices from the field. Very, very good one. Very good. You can use it and get a clear understanding. What the security posture. Another tool that Aqua has is the Kubench, which assesses the security posture by CIS benchmarks. And again, there's a lot of tools out there. Just a couple of examples. Now, when we are thinking about network threats, the first thing we need to take under consideration and understand and know that out of the box, if you don't configure policies, all communication internally and externally of the pods are allowed. All the pods can communicate with all of them. No blockage, everything is allowed. So this, not a lot of people know this fact, but this is a fact. And this is a very huge security risk. So you have a flat system right now when you deploy the Kubernetes out of the box. You must configure how groups of pods communicate with each other, create firewall rules between them, create a whitelist, a blacklist for them. Now, if you don't know or having trouble, there's a lot of recipes out there that use cases. Use cases on how to configure your Kubernetes cluster or how to configure your pods, your environment. If you are right now, for example, you can see the diagram over here, you have a web app with a front end and you want the external traffic to be only allowed to the app web. And the app web will communicate only with the two backends, app 4, app bar, but they won't be able to communicate with each other. How do you implement such a configuration? If you don't know, go to these recipes and you will help you configure it. They also provide you with configuration files that you just need to edit to align with your environment. And from there, you just can deploy it inside your system, in your Kubernetes cluster, and you got yourself network policies in a very easy way. And I said recipes for network, but also there's a lot of open source tools over there that helps you get visibility and also governance on your network traffic. So I highly recommend you go to Google and find one tool that I'm really fond of is Cilium. It's an open source tool. It's very powerful. It's based on eBPF. It's an amazing tool to give you visibility inside your environment. Malicious containers. Again, this is one of the most popular attack vectors in a Kubernetes environment. You need to ensure that all of the management ports require authentication for all users. You can't just leave things as is with the default. All service accounts that you have in your system, you must ensure that the container that is running in production doesn't have any service account mounted to it. This is something that sometimes is being forgotten inside the Docker file or in the YAML that you deploy your environment. You need to be sure that. Network policies, restrict access. We talked about network policies in the previous slide, but again, this is very important. If you have a malicious container right now and you implement the right network policies, that container won't be able to do anything but communicate with a specific set of objects that you allowed it to. And you will be able to control the blast radius in case you have been breached. Ensure that only scanned images are running inside your cluster. I highly recommend, White Source has a very good container scanning tool that you can take and use to scan your container, your images, and provide you with and align with the security guideline that your organization requires. Don't run images that you're not sure on what are the security posture. Pod security policies and third-party tools is also a very good way to get governance and control on your container, either in runtime or in pre-runtime before you deploy it. You are able to assess the configuration, the security posture of your Kubernetes, of your container image. And then you can decide, do you want to deploy it? Do you want to kill the deployment? You can do whatever. There's a lot of stuff you can do. We're also going to talk about it in the upcoming slides. So there are open source tools that helps you perform these exact actions that I just described. There are two icons here. One, the top one is Kiverno, and the bottom one is OPA. Stolen credentials, malicious users. There is a lot of with all the configuration that we just talked about, you need to gain full visibility on all the components that you have inside your Kubernetes cluster, and what are the policies, the user rights that each of them has, what resources I have in my environment, and do I as Maor have the following credentials? You need to ensure that when you run a container or you add a user to the cluster for work purposes, he has the least privileges access that enable him to perform the work that he needs to do, but he's not able to do some sort of malicious activities, even by mistake. We talked about pod's security policies in the previous slide. It also helps us to manage the blast of privileged containers. So if right now I'm deploying a container and I have a service account or a root user, which is, or I forgot, inside my container, with pod security policies and also with OPA and other tools, you're able to gain visibility into that and protect yourself, protect your etcd. As I said, this is the database of your Kubernetes cluster. If I get access to it, I can change whatever I want, from user credentials, deployments, configuration, and more. So if someone in the organization needs access to it, ensure that it communicates and connects to it with a client certificate. API server, again, we talked about it, but it's a very important thing to protect your API server. Not only everyone needs to access your master node, not everyone needs to have access to the API server, and no from a visibility perspective, or from I forgot that the user had access to it. Another thing to be aware of, that the user accounts are concealed cluster-wide, which is a very forgotten fact that usually admins forget. And validate all the user across your namespace. Ensure that you know which user you have inside your system. Now, it's a lot. There's a lot of configurations over here. Now, the icon over here that you can see is for a company that is called A-Policy. It's a very nice company that the main goal is to assess the configuration of the Kubernetes cluster. It does some of the configuration that you see here and more. Now, for the past 40 minutes, I shared a lot of information and bombarded you guys with a lot of data. And in the same way, when I created this slide deck, when I came to here, I looked for the right picture. So I think this picture illustrates the feeling that I had when I created. So, okay, there's a lot of data. There's a lot of stuff that needs to be done. Where do I need to go from here? How I'm taking all this data and doing stuff with it in order to protect my Kubernetes cluster? So first thing that I recommend is create attack trees for this helps to create a threat modeling. Attack trees provide us a formal steps on how the security and the different components stand, hold ground, and how they can be exploited on specific use cases. They give us a clear understanding on and visibility into the attacker way of thinking and what are the steps. Okay. And I think it was a year ago that the CNCF financial user group, produced the set of attack trees that helps us to determine how the attacker got his foot in the door inside your cluster. And and they map it to a specific use cases. And there are two main scenarios, two main approach that they took, the bottom up and the scenario approach. Let's talk about that. So the bottom up approach helps us to focus on the helps us to focus and understand what is the goal of the attacker. It helps us take a visual representation and clear understanding on all the security controls that I have right now in the system and how are they, what is the coverage that they provide me on the specific entry points that the attacker has. And again, the main focus is on the goal. For example, denial of service, DOS attacks. Another approach is the scenario approach. The scenario approach is, I prefer it. It's much more realistic view on the attack that is being conducted inside your environment. Sorry, it's not being conducted, can be conducted inside your environment. It helps us to map up all the different attack vectors. Okay, and we're gonna drill down into one of them in a second. And better understand exactly on what are the different steps that the attacker is doing, where he goes when he performs different attacks, and how I can gain a more realistic view and implement security controls on the different steps that he will take. Now, this is one of the examples, and again, one of the examples and a portion, because the attack trees that they created is huge. So this is a small image, a snippet from a compromised application, which is a compromised container. One of the most common attack vectors out there. It provides us a clear understanding and assessing all the security controls. If you can look, you need to look at it on the top is the goal. Push poison image to the image repository, for example. This is the goal. This is the final step that the attacker is doing. And you can go down. And you can go down, okay? So it does, you can go down to do some sort of reverse engineering to understand what are the steps while they're going back. It's a bit confusing, but it is. It's very helpful. The attack tree displays the starting points of the compromised container and a very detailed part of the exploitation. And it's very useful. So at the end of this slide, I'm gonna share with you the slide deck, so you're able to access everything and you'll be able to see it by yourself and see the full tree. Now, another way, another security control that we can use is the Mother Attack Framework. For those of you who doesn't know, are not familiar with this framework, with this tool, is a detailed knowledge base of tactics and techniques that attackers use to infiltrate into specific environment. In our case, it's a Kubernetes system, and in order to carry on their attack. Now, I think it was past April last year, that I had the privilege to work with the actual attack team on the MITRE ATT&CK framework for containers. So we mapped out all the different tactics and techniques that the attacker can use in order to infiltrate inside into a container image. And Microsoft released, I think it was, they just released an update, I think like 6 months ago, on the MITRE ATT&CK framework for Kubernetes and container systems. So, and I, for both of these frameworks, for those both of these tables, I had a problem because we didn't focus on only Kubernetes. We didn't focus on a cloud agnostic environment, which is, can be either private or public. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to create my own threat metrics, which will be focused only on Kubernetes without the container vectors or techniques. And this is what you can see here on the table here. Now with this tool, this security team can better understand the different attack techniques that the adversary is using in order to exploit a Kubernetes-based environment, and also can provide you a solid foundation for developing a more effective defense practices against those tactics. Now, with this holistic view, organizations can gain a comprehensive understanding and on the adversary techniques and develops very robust security controls in order to improve the security posture of the Kubernetes environment and protect also the Kubernetes workload that they are running on top of that. So another way you can help and mitigate all the security issues and provide coverage on all the risks that you saw on previous slides is using the policy of code approach, which is it's a way to implement a code inside your system. It leverage a high level language. For example, if we're looking at the open policy agent, it uses Rego language in order to implement security controls and provide governance and automation capabilities into the system. It helps your organizations to gain clear visibility, clear enforcement on what is running inside your environment, how it runs. Again, it gives you clear understanding on how to align with best practices guidelines from the security team. And it's a very simple way. It's a very powerful tools, both of them. I know that the open policy also provides for infrastructure as code environments and also for Kubernetes base and containers. Caverno is it's a very easy, intuitive tool that helps us do the same thing, but not based on Lego, just based on Kubernetes YAMLs and very simple language. So we talked about a lot of stuff. We talked about the tools, mitigations, best practices, what we can use, how we can use it. Okay. So at the end of at the end of it, what we need to do is just start working. We need to look at our environment, all the different dependencies. You need to start implementing security best practices, CIS, PCI, align with the SecOps, and do whatever needs to be done in order to protect your Kubernetes environment. So there are three main pillars that I'm looking at it. So on the first pillar is the Kubernetes configuration. If you remember, we talked about it in the slide deck. So Kubernetes configuration is the main fear and pain point that organizations have when they are deploying Kubernetes inside the environment. So I highly recommend you, and also talked about these tools, KubeHunter and KubeBench, assess the security posture, assess the security configuration of your cluster on a regular basis. I highly recommend using these two tools, very good tools. Add security guardrails, which open policy agent, Caverno, and Cilium create some sort of logic rules, which you can get from your security operations in order to create very clear guidelines on what and how can be running inside your environment. And if you're looking at runtime security, you have Falco, Tracy, and KubeArmor. These are very popular open source tools that are focusing on runtime security, and you can implement them in your Kubernetes environment and help you guys, again, get another hand and control to the system. If you want more information, all the topics that I listed, all the information that I covered here can be accessed from these links. And if you have any specific questions, guys, feel free to reach out to me. This is my email, okay? I love to conduct conversation about this topic. I love to talk about cloud native. This is what I'm doing for the past 3 years, I think, if I remember correctly, time flies. Again, I'm here for you guys. Any questions, go for it. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate each and every one of you who joined. And if anyone asks you when you became a Kubernetes expert, feel free to say today. Back to you, Julio.
Excellent, thank you. I just want to remind everybody that today's webinar has been recorded. So if you missed any or all of the webinar, you will be able to watch it again. We will be sending an email with a link to access the webinar on demand, and you can also find it on devops.com. Just look in the on-demand section in the webinars page, and you will find it there. I did mention at the beginning that we were doing a drawing for four $25 Amazon gift cards, so I will announce the winners. Our first winner today is Bianca P. Congratulations, Bianca. Our second winner is Sandy R. Our third winner is Robert F. And our final winner is Anthony A. So congratulations to all our winners. We'll be reaching out to you via email with instructions for claiming your Amazon gift card. So please check your inbox. And if you don't see it there, check your spam folder. Oh, Mayor, I would like to thank you very much for taking the time to put this presentation together. And I'd also like to thank the audience for their time and engagement. This is Julio Godinez signing off. Until next time, take care, everyone.